what are the narratives here? You have Joe Biden, who's obviously bungled this beyond all recognition, and to the credit of the mainstream media, has actually, they've actually recognized that. I mean, most of the time, most of the reporting has actually been pretty good here. They have called him out. They have, I've heard...
There's no way you can't.
There's no way you can't. Right, there's no way
you can't. This is the first thing in my lifetime that I have seen that wasn't some sort of dirty backroom scandal that warrants impeachment.
Oh, yeah.
This is an impeachable offense.
That's right. This is different than... hey, there's a scandal. This is just he's doing such a bad job.
This is not Nixon. This is not, I fooled around with cigars and that intern. It's none of that.
No.
This is, it took 40 hours for Boris Johnson to get our president on the phone.
It's absolutely inexplicable. Cannot happen. Cannot happen. They're our top ally. They were there with us through almost all of this.
They do not trust. No ally trusts us anymore. You
should
think
they? I
we
can't
have
even blame
another
them.
Hit on the 20th anniversary of September 11th? No one will stand with us again. No one. This guy, he was a moderate. Wrong. Mm. He was going to bring us back together. Wrong. He was gonna bring the credibility of the presidency and the United States of America back to the world stage. Really? Because not a single, I'm not saying they liked Donald Trump, but at least they respected Donald Trump. At least they may not have liked him. They may not have wanted him to be president. But they knew Donald Trump was a force to be reckoned with, and he actually would talk to them. How is it this president? Because it's not like you and me are like, oh, gee, you know, I was out at the beach, and I left my cell phone in the car. There is someone always with the president of the United States. How many times, this is what I really want to know, how many times did Boris Johnson call? And how many times did someone walk into the president and say, Mr. President, the prime minister is trying desperately to get a hold of you? How many times did that happen? And if it didn't happen, who's actually running this country? Because there's no way Boris Johnson can't get someone to walk into the president's office and say, he really needs to talk to you. There's no way.
Yeah, he's either saying no or we really, I mean, Biden has nothing to do with this, which I don't believe, frankly. I think that exonerates him from the terrible job he has done here. I think he is in control, and that's a huge problem. I mean, sometimes we have bad thoughts, Glenn.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Sometimes we have to admit these things. Sometimes we believe we get tempted by something bad, or we have a bad negative thought.
Mm-hmm.
I had a bad thought.
Okay.
The other day.
Wash it. First thing you have to do is lance it.
Release it.
Yeah.
Would it be better to actually have Kamala Harris as president? Now so, I stop myself quickly.
Can I tell you something?
But like at least I said think that, she'd be awake.
I said that this morning. I was
Did
talking
really?
To Pat, and I said. It couldn't get worse, and everybody in the room went, oh, yes, it can.
And yes, I can.
And you're right, it could, but at least we would know that she was there.
Right.
I have no idea who's running this country, and I agree with you. The way he has defended this, I do think this was his plan.
Yeah.
I think he's 100% responsible for this.
Yep.
Did you hear about the argument that our 82nd Airborne had with the SAS? Okay, so this comes from the ground.
Okay.
One of the commanders of the 82nd Airborne, there in Kabul at the airport, actually dressed down the commander of the SAS. That's their like Delta Force.
Mm-hmm.
Because the SAS... And France are leaving the airport and going out and getting and rescuing people.
Mm-hmm.
And our commander of the 82nd Airborne said to the SAS, you're putting our deal in jeopardy.
What?
Uh-huh. you're causing trouble, and the Taliban will renege on our deal. Oh my gosh. Apparently, from what I hear from the ground, the members of the 82nd Airborne are crazy angry. Crazy angry. And they should be.
Because they want to go out and save the people.
Oh my gosh.
They want to go out and do what they are capable of doing. And that is, you know, how many people we've been doing this show, Glenn, for this entire war. This entire war.
Entire war.
This show became nationally syndicated. We signed the deal in August 2001. So we
started the week of September 11th.
Yeah, we were scheduled to start January 2002. They moved it up till right after September 11th after the attacks. So this has been the arc of our entire show, our entire career, at least for me, and a good chunk of it for you.
Half a bun.
Yeah. And we've talked to thousands of people who have fought in that war at this point. Thousands of them that have come in, whether they've had experiences there, whether they've come back home and have struggled, and this audience has raised millions of dollars for them, whether it's been people who have written books telling the whole story. To a man, to a woman, all of them would say right now what they want to do is go out and get these people and get them the hell out of this country.
Yeah. We don't leave people behind.
No.
That is one of our strengths. China, kill them. Slaughter them. We'll make more.
Mm-hmm.
Not
That's
America.
The way they think. Yeah.
That is the Judeo-Christian value. We value life. All life. We save soldiers on the other side. That's who we are. And this administration and all of these CRT bull crap people, this is going to be a very
a
difficult
show. Hey, we lasted 20 years. Maybe this is the last
my
one.
My gosh, all of these people are they hate us so much. They believe that this is who we are. So it doesn't matter to them. America is just a horrible place anyway that just treats people horribly and they don't care. So that's what they're doing. You believe it? It is. You're the ones in charge now. You could be the ones who say, no, America's not like that. And we go help people. The middle of the country. And every single soldier knows what the right thing to do is. And I have news for you. If the Taliban thinks this is over, you better be very careful. Because once these clowns are out of office, I will personally buy all of the silver bullets with the names of each member of the Taliban. I'll engrave them with my fingernails if I have to. And I would love to see them deposited in the heads of every... Oh, you were a member of the Taliban? Boom! This is not us. This is not us. We were dressed down yesterday. Do you know this, right? About our military shooting members of the Taliban?
Mm-hmm.
And they were dressed down for it? You know why they were shooting the Taliban? Because the Taliban was shooting women and children. And they were in front of the gates, and so our Marines saw that and went, let's kill the bad guys. And they got in trouble for it.
Incredible.
By the way, another thing, I just want you to know, the government is telling you, if you're there, just get to the airport. Every other country is going out and getting theirs. We're telling everyone, you just got to get to the airport. We are flying planes out at 50% capacity. No one else is doing that. We are. We are. And we are abandoning all of those people there. Not on my frickin' watch. Not with you. Not with me. Not with the vast majority of Americans. No. No. I will tell you, last night I went to bed. I am $20 million is a lot of money. And 5,000 human beings is a lot of pressure. I want to just share some of the thoughts I had last night because I think it's really important. But I give you my word we will do everything, everything that is moral. And I can't say legal because it would be legal with the Taliban. So moral and legal, as we understand it, not as the Taliban understands it, we will, I don't care how long it takes us, we will get those people out.